Fannie Lou Hamer was a force to be reckoned with, enduring intractable racism, police beatings, and even forced sterilization. She never stopped working for equal voting rights for all. This is the tragic real-life story of Fannie Lou Hamer. Born on October 6, 1917 in Montgomery County, Mississippi, Fannie Lou was the 20th and youngest child of Luella and James Townsend. Both Luella and James worked as sharecroppers their entire lives. When Fannie Lou was just 6 years old, she joined them despite having endured a bout of polio just a year earlier. Hamer was 8 years old in 1925 when she saw Joe Pullum, a local sharecropper, lynched. In an interview with Jack O'Dell in 1965, she said, "I remember that until this day, and I won't forget it." Poverty forced Hamer to drop out of school at the age of 12, and by the age of 13, she was picking as much as 400 pounds of cotton in a day and receiving $1 for her work. Since Hamer had learned how to read and write during her brief time in school, she also worked as a record keeper on the plantation and soon discovered just how the owners would cook the books to cheat the poor sharecroppers out of their fair wages. To offset this, Hamer began secretly tilting the scales to ensure people weren't cheated. She later recalled, "I didn't know what to do, and all I could do was rebel in the only way I could rebel." In 1944, Fannie Lou married Perry Pap Hamer, a tractor driver on a local plantation. 17 years later, in 1961, she underwent surgery to remove a small cyst in her stomach. When she woke, she discovered that she'd also been given a hysterectomy without her consent. According to PBS, this type of forced sterilization was so common at the time that it became referred to as a Mississippi appendectomy, a term coined by Hamer herself. On June 8, 1964, Hamer testified before a panel in Washington, D.C. that at the North Sunflower County Hospital, 6 out of the 10 Negro women that go to the hospital are sterilized with the tubes tied. Forced sterilizations have a dark history and an equally dark present in the United States. Indiana passed the first forced sterilization law in 1907, and while they hit their peak in the 1930s and 1940s, targeting those deemed to be criminals or unfit by the 1950s, sterilization laws started targeting welfare recipients as well. Forced sterilizations were frequently racially motivated. This became abundantly clear when Mississippi proposed a bill that would make it a felony for a parent on welfare to have more than one child. Jail time could be avoided if the parent consented to sterilization. Ultimately, sterilization was removed from that bill, but untold women like Hamer still were sterilized without their consent. On August 31, 1962, Hamer and 17 others went to the courthouse in Indianola, Mississippi to register to vote. According to PBS, most of the group was blocked from even attempting to register. Only Hamer and one other man were allowed to fill out an application and take a literacy test. At the time, literacy tests were purposefully designed to keep black people from voting. And when Hamer was asked to explain de facto laws, she later recalled that, "I knowed as much about a facto law as a horse knows about Christmas Day." After failing the literacy test, the group was denied the right to register to vote. On the way home, their bus was stopped by police and fined $100 for being too yellow. Then the persecution got worse. The owner of the plantation where Hamer worked and lived demanded that she withdraw her application to vote.
"Mr. Marlowe told me that I would have to go down and withdraw my registration or leave because they wasn't ready for that in Mississippi."
Hamer refused and was immediately thrown off the plantation where she had lived and worked for 18 years. She temporarily stayed with a friend before finding a new home, and just narrowly missed being murdered by those who were trying to suppress the black vote.
"They shot in the house 15 times, thinking that I was there."
On January 10, 1963, Hamer was finally able to pass the literacy test. According to The Nation, after her second attempt on December 4th, she told the registrar, quote, "You'll see me every 30 days till I pass." A month later, she passed. But despite now being registered to vote, she discovered that she still wasn't allowed to vote because she didn't have any poll tax receipts. In some parts of the United States, people were required to pay a tax in order to vote, a tax put in place to ensure that the poorest people, who were often people of color, didn't get a voice in the government. And they weren't subtle about this fact either. For instance, in 1939, Alabama's Tuscaloosa News published an editorial that read in part, This newspaper believes in white supremacy, and it believes that the poll tax is one of the essentials for the preservation of white supremacy. In 1962, the United States passed the 24th Amendment, which outlawed poll taxes for federal elections. Despite this, Hamer was still denied the right to vote a year later because it wasn't really enforced until 1965. And to this day, 8 states, including Mississippi, still haven't ratified the amendment. While Papp worked to pay off their sharecropping debt at the plantation, Hamer continued working toward voter registration and desegregation. On June 9, 1963, Hamer and 9 other activists were returning on a bus from a voter registration and civic education training session in Charleston, South Carolina. The activists had tried to integrate lunch counters at the various bus stations along their way home, and their protests had enraged their bus driver. According to Fannie Lou Hamer, America's Freedom Fighting Woman by Megan Parker Brooks, the driver began using the phone at every stop, reporting their location to Mississippi police. In Winona, Mississippi, police arrested at least 6 of the activists, even those who'd remain on the bus, and took them to jail. Hamer and her fellow activists weren't released from jail until June 12th. And in those 3 days, Hamer sustained such severe and prolonged beatings that she suffered from lifelong damage to her kidneys, eyes, and legs. In addition to beating the activists themselves, police also forced the other black people who were also imprisoned in the jail at the time to beat the activists as well. While there was later a brief trial, the police were cleared for their actions. After several failed attempts to work with the all-white pro-segregation Mississippi Democratic Party, Hamer co-founded the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, and in 1964, she went to the Democratic National Convention in an attempt to get representation. As a result, she received death threats. When she reported them to the police, they told her, quote, "Don't look to us for help." On August 22, 1964, Hamer testified before the Credentials Committee at the Democratic National Convention. She started by stating her full name and home address, defiantly signaling her fearlessness to every white supremacist. According to the Washington Post, President Johnson was terrified that her testimony at the convention would break up the coalition of white Southern delegates he needed to get elected. He tried to convince her not to speak, but when she did anyway, he abruptly called a pointless live press conference so the TV broadcast would have to cut away from Hamer's testimony. It backfired, bringing more media attention to Hamer's testimony than it otherwise might have gotten, with many evening news programs giving full coverage of the speech that Johnson had interrupted.
"Because our lives be threatened daily, because we want to live as decent human beings in America."
As a result of pressure from President Johnson and vice presidential candidate Hubert Humphrey, the convention refused to accept Hamer as an official delegate. Instead, officials offered a farcical compromise to the MFDP. They'd be allowed 2 delegates, but they could neither sit in the Mississippi section, nor would they be able to cast votes. Oh, and neither one of those seats were allowed to go to Hamer. Why? According to Humphrey, the president has said he will not let that illiterate woman speak on the floor of the Democratic convention. The Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party voted unanimously to reject the administration's compromise. In Hamer's words, quote, "We didn't come all this way for no 2 seats." They returned to Mississippi, shut out once again by a process meant to empower them. In 1964, Hamer also ran unsuccessfully for Congress. According to an interview with Jack O'Dell, Hamer recalled that it was harder for her to pass the literacy test in order to register to vote than it was for her to qualify to run for Congress. And despite being barred from the official ballot, the MFDP gave out freedom ballots that included candidates of all races. According to Smithsonian Magazine, after her first bid was unsuccessful, Hamer ran for office 2 more times in 1967 and 1971. Unfortunately, her 1967 run was disqualified on a technicality, and she lost to the incumbent in 1971. She did have one moment of triumph, though. In 1968, the Democratic Party began requiring equal representation for state delegations, and she finally was recognized as an official delegate for Mississippi at the National Democratic Party Convention. She used her platform to protest the ongoing war in Vietnam. Seeing that not much progress was being made on the political front, Fannie Lou Hamer turned most of her attention toward economic justice as a way to fight for racial equality. In 1969, Hamer founded the Freedom Farm Cooperative in order to provide black people with land that they could own and farm collectively. With the help of donors such as the Measure for Measure organization and Harry Belafonte, by 1970, the co-op had amassed 680 acres for cultivation. Membership for the co-op was $1 a month, and even though only 30 families could afford the dues, those who couldn't pay weren't excluded. Roughly an additional 1,500 families were also part of the Freedom Farm Cooperative in name. In 1970, the collective also started a pig bank for impoverished families. With help from the National Council of Negro Women, the collective purchased 5 male pigs and 35 female pigs, and over the next 3 years, thousands of pigs made their way to black families. Hamer especially loved the pig bank, stating that, quote, "I wouldn't take nothing for our golden pigs." Unfortunately, without institutional backing or resources, the Freedom Farm Collective only lasted a handful of years. But at its height, it was one of the largest employers in Sunflower County, Mississippi. According to the Center for Constitutional Rights, Hamer was actually partly responsible for the Voting Rights Act's passage thanks to her 1965 civil rights case, Hamer v. Campbell. Brought against the Circuit Clerk of Mississippi for restricting black people's right to register and vote, Hamer's victory in court even allowed the elections to be overturned due to their discriminatory practices. Even after the Voting Rights Act was finally passed in 1965, Fannie Lou Hamer continued to focus on equal voting rights. Despite the federal protections that the Voting Rights Act claimed to guarantee, though, white people in power continued to try to prevent black people from registering and voting. Still, she fought on. According to PBS, in 1970, Hamer organized plaintiffs for a class action lawsuit regarding school desegregation in Sunflower County. This suit resulted in the district court ordering the county to merge its segregated schools into a single public school system. Fannie Lou Hamer's health suffered during her final years. In 1976, she was diagnosed with breast cancer and underwent a radical mastectomy. She continued her civil rights work as long as she could, but as her health worsened, fundraising and public speaking became more and more difficult. Hamer died on March 14, 1977, her life cut tragically short at the age of 59. Hundreds of people came to pay their respects, but some regretted the media circus that transpired. According to Fannie Lou Hamer, The Life of a Civil Rights Icon by Ernest N. Bracey, some of her fellow activists believed that dignitaries looking for a photo op ended up overshadowing coverage of Hamer's life and work and the mourning being done by her real friends, family, and neighbors. Hamer was buried at the Freedom Farm Cooperative, and her gravestone bears her famous motto,
"We are sick and tired of being sick and tired."
Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more grunge videos about your favorite stuff are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.